A four-month-old Chandler baby was taken to the hospital earlier this month. The baby was severely injured and burned by a cigarette. But what makes the story even more disturbing is that the baby was under the watch of the state's Child Protective Services. It's a kind of failure that Arizona Republic columnist Laurie Roberts has been reporting on for years. She's going after public records that might help explain what went wrong in this latest case. And she joins us now to talk about CPS and her efforts to hold the agency accountable. It's good to see you again. The last time we had you on the show, we talked about not this case, obviously, but this very same thing. What is wrong? What is, two-part question. What's wrong with CPS, or are they doing the best they can under this current situation?
Boy, that's the million-dollar question, isn't it? What is wrong with CPS? The same thing that's been wrong with them for years and years and years. I met with the director of CPS, Clarence Carter, not too long ago, and he described just this culture of bunker mentality where when there's a problem, you just bury it. You don't talk about it. You don't deal with it. Nothing to see here. Move on. Well, when you do that, you don't really fix what ails the system. Now, having said that, I also have to acknowledge that they are under a tremendous budget strain. But I tend to begin to get the feeling that they're going to say, well, that's why all of these things are happening. And yet, when these children's bodies wash up on the shore and we get the chance to see what really happened by getting those records, I'm often not seeing cases where it looks to be so much about money as it looks to be about poor decision making.
The bunker mentality, is it coming from mid-level, high-level caseworkers?
I don't believe that it's coming from caseworkers. I believe that the culture in a place is set by those people who've been there a long time, and that would lead me to conclude that it's probably middle management, which sort of just waits out DES director after DES director, each one of whom vows to change the culture of the place.
So if there are 11,000 some odd kids in the system right now that the state, that CPS is looking over, can the agency adequately look after these kids as it is currently configured with the people currently in position?
Hard to say, because we can't see into the agency. Despite the talk of transparency, there is still a trash bag across the wall of the place, so to speak. I would have to question why there are so many kids in there. I hear from grandparent after grandparent who have custody of their children or their grandchildren because their own children are addicted to meth, which is a huge part of the equation in this whole thing. And time after time after time, those kids are taken away from them when mommy gets clean for 10 or 15 minutes and they're back in the home. And I wonder if you just don't at some point cut some of those things off, allow the grandparents to take off with the children and get them out of the whole system. Are we looking at, in other words, the right cases, or are we looking at the cases that are wrong and thus missing some
that
other things?
That sounds systemic there. That
could be.
Yeah.
We can't see. Again, the trash bag is over the wall.
The idea of budget cuts hitting the agency itself, hitting DES, the idea of budget cuts to other services making for more cases because there are kids and parents in situations that become more difficult because of fewer overall budget cuts, the impact, is that what are we starting to see the results of some of these cuts with some of these kids?
I don't know that we're starting to see them. I think that we've seen them all along. Again, the stories of these children dying are no different than the stories that we were telling in the flush times. Now, did that play a role in little Jacob, the six-year-old who was killed? We don't know, because we haven't seen the records to see what happened in that case. But certainly they've got some budget issues, and shame on the legislature for not giving them what they need. This particular director has an opportunity, I think, should he have the guts to do it, to both speak truth to power above and try to get the people below him to change the culture and really make some real changes in that place.
We've had Mr. Carter on the program when he first started, so he wasn't quite, you know, up to speed on some of the things, as I'm sure he is now. You've talked to him as well. Does he seem like he gets it?
He gets it that there's a problem, and he is probably, I would guess, not going to allow anybody to say all of this is happening because of the budget cuts, and if we just had enough money, everything would be wonderful, and children and parents would be reunited, and wouldn't it be a wonderful world? I think he gets that. What I don't know about him yet is, will he be willing to tell his boss, the governor, that we've gone too far in cuts to this agency, and it's time to restore some of this money and give them what they need? But, I mean, if Mr. Carter were asking my advice, which he hasn't done, nobody asked my advice, I would tell him that before you go and look for that money, do a good audit of that agency to find out how you're spending the money that you have. There's no doubt that they've been cut and that they've been hurt. But I hear from some people in the agency that question whether the money is well spent now as it's spent and whether there's some waste in there still.
But aren't there supposed to be standards as to how many cases certain caseworkers should have and these sorts of things?
Right.
And those standards have been blown by a long time ago.
Those standards have never been met, ever.
Yeah. So I mean, it does seem systemic. You've got too few people handling too many cases. You've got poor decisions running rampant over there.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I do think it is. I do think that it is a systemic problem that they've got. Is it because of the budget? Partially, but I think that we'd be doing the kids of this community a disservice to just say, oh, if they just had more money, everything would be fine, because every time one of these bodies rolls up to shore and you pull these records, you find just some breathtakingly astonishing bad decisions that have been made, and nobody's caught it.
Yeah.
And I can give you some examples.
Well, we don't have time for the examples, although we've read about your examples, and it's difficult reading. It's probably difficult for you to report on as well. That being said, it's also difficult to get information out of this age. What is going on there? Why is this happening? Why is it so a fight just to get the basic information?
Because you can't get into a bunker. This is the problem. They control the information, it appears, and I say they, I don't know who they is over there, but give you an example. I'm trying to get the records on this little baby, 4 months old, who showed up at the hospital near death, 14 broken bones, and her arm used as an ashtray. And she is in the hands of a CPS safety monitor. The question is a simple one. How did this child wind up to be with this safety monitor, and what steps did CPS take to check the background of both her and her living boyfriend to make sure that they were appropriate? Now, is that an unreasonable question? All I get from them is, we can't even acknowledge that this child was part of us. I said, but then I quote them the law. It doesn't matter. They say, well, you can't prove it's a near fatality. Well, the police report quotes the doctors as saying the child was brought in in a near-death incident involving non-accidental trauma. I don't know. And so I say, what does it take for you to understand that this is a near fatality and thus the information should be available? We would have to have a doctor sign a medical form. And it's bureaucracy. Answer the questions.
We're running out of time here, and I'm sorry about that because I have so many more questions. But with this particular case, didn't we have a special session of the legislature? Haven't we had laws passed and amendments passed to laws
that
are supposed to address this transparency problem?
They're ignoring it. We have sent in a demand letter to them this week saying, follow the law. Give us the records. Even former House Speaker Kirk Adams contacted me today after reading a blog that I'd written about the fact that we were having difficulty with this. And he was one of the two sponsors, along with Jonathan Payton, to open up those records and make it more transparent in the hope that when you can see things, things change. People are held accountable, systems are held accountable, and things change. And he said to me, it's right back to where it was. This is very disappointing. They're not following the law.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Great job reporting. Thanks for keeping us informed on this, because it's devastating to read about this. I mean, you just don't understand. You can't make heads or tails of it.
Well, they're never going to save them all. The question that I would like them to be able to answer is, have you done your damnedest to save the ones that you can, and have you done your jobs?
All right. Laurie, good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.